It all started with a very simple idea. Tell the stories of how successful middle market CEOs made it to the corner office. I'm Brand Handley, founder and managing director of Resource Options International, or ROI. We're the USA's premier executive search firm focused exclusively on empowering middle market companies to attract, hire, and retain A players while transforming top executives' careers and lives. ROI's Into the Corner office is dedicated to discovering how middle market CEOs advance their career, and we're making these remarkable and sometimes quite unbelievable stories available to you for the very first time. Listen and learn about the challenges they've overcome, the interesting people they've met along the way, and the lessons learned that steered these executives' unique journey into a middle market corner office of their own. I know you enjoy these CEO stories as much as I've enjoyed recording them. So thank you for listening today. And if you like what you've heard, rate us on iTunes or wherever you get your podcasts. I'm looking forward to you joining me on the next great middle market CEO adventure into the corner office. My guest today is Todd Stewart. Todd graduated from Stephen F. Austin State University with a Bachelor of Science in Marketing and immediately joined Gulf Winds International in 1996. Beginning as a forklift operator, he has served with or led every department within the company, leading to his current position of president. Todd's a longtime member of the C12 Group and continues to learn how Gulf Winds International is here to serve a greater purpose and hold strongly to the biblical servant leadership model that empowers team members to grow personally, professionally, and spiritually. Todd Stewart, welcome into the corner office.
Thank you for having me.
Oh, gosh, it's great to hear you live now. And the first time I heard you was back in May. We're both members of the C12 organization, me for just a couple of years, you for much longer. And I was so inspired by your keynote address and was so pleased when you agreed to be on our podcast. So I'm really looking forward to this, to learn more about you and your company and how Christ has really played a role in you building such an incredible, inspiring and growing organization. But let's start a little bit about the early years. Tell me a little bit about where you grew up and, you know, what your early family life was like, Todd.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I grew up in a very middle-class family. My father was in the shipping business for probably 25 years. So I grew up in Atascocita here, which is northeast of Houston, just a suburb. Went to a humble high school and graduated there and went off to Stephen F. Austin. But
brothers and sisters.
Only child.
Okay.
And both parents worked. My mother was a nurse by trade. And then, of course, my dad was in the shipping business.
What were some of the early memories that you had of mom and dad, you know, early inspirations or things that perhaps they encouraged you to do in early age?
You know, my parents were both hardworking people. And I think from early on, I knew that they both cared for me and loved me. And I was fortunate enough to have both grandparents that I knew as well. So they didn't live too far, Southeast Texas. So we just spent time with family and obviously felt like they were good parents from that standpoint. My father was not a believer. So he did not really invest in me on that side. So my faith journey didn't start till much later. My mother had been kind of the one that walked away from faith. Her dad, my grandfather, was really the one that told me I needed Christ. But she was kind of the child that bucked the system a little bit and wound up in a relationship with a guy that didn't know the Lord. And while he was a great provider and a good father in a lot of ways, we missed out on so much from a spiritual perspective in those early years. But God's so gracious, and I'll talk more about how we kind of made that up in the later years.
Yeah. Well, you talked about your grandfather as being an inspiration. I assume that was on your mother's side. Is that right?
That's correct. Yeah, he was a deacon in the Baptist church and worked for a utility company, retired after 35 years, and literally built his own little house up in the country, deep East Texas, back where he was from. And they retired up there. And unfortunately, not long after that, he was diagnosed with lung cancer. And that's really what led ultimately to him talking to me about the Lord.
Yeah. Yeah. Who are some of the other folks that inspired you? You know, not having brothers and sisters, you know, did you reach out? Were there teachers or did you go to Sunday school? Was mom and dad at all interested in that? Or as you said, I guess that came later in life.
Yeah, you know, we really went to church pretty much on Easter and Christmas with my grandparents. Other than that, I didn't have a lot of spiritual influence there. Certainly, I can look back at some teachers that were very inspirational in my life early on, and some that just kind of watched me through those teenage years and sometimes informed my parents of things that I shouldn't have been doing. And so that was fun.
Yeah, kept the guardrails up, right?
Yeah.
Were you a good student in school, Todd?
I would say I was an above average student. I really enjoyed being, frankly, I liked being outdoors. That was always my love, being outside. Yeah. And so I played sports growing up. And so was always involved in football from the time I was in probably second or third grade, and baseball, and did track, threw the shot put and discus. So just enjoyed sports. Really, that was kind of my influences, if you will, were more my coaches.
Right.
And so that side was, they invest so much in their kids, obviously, because you spend a lot of time with coaches and you're kind of in the battle. And so I love sports from that perspective, just how it prepares people to go through difficulty and adversity. And absolutely. Certainly the team atmosphere there is wonderful, and it's hard to sweat with people and go through all that you go through on during two-a-days and that kind of stuff in the Texas heat without it developing some character, for sure.
Absolutely. And you play all the way through high school?
I did. Yeah. I did. And
any dreams of playing college ball and in any of those sports that you engaged with?
You know, I thought about it. I had a bit of a hiccup in my high school career that sort of changed kind of the direction of where I was going. I had basically my senior year. This turned out to be a great life lesson, but senior year, I was competing for the starting quarterback job on the team and had a really great spring season, if you will, and felt like I did what I need to earn the job. Through a touchdown pass, I remember in the scrimmage game, that was one of the ones when the race was getting tight. And so just felt like I'd performed well enough to get the job. And unfortunately, I did not get the job.
And so
what happened was the team wanted me to play on defense. And so I wound up playing safety. And my whole career, I played quarterback from the time I was in third grade. So I literally had to make a massive change and go to the opposite side of the ball. Later, I had a guy that I played with who wound up playing in the NFL for quite a few years, who was really good. He got hurt on the offensive side of the ball. And so I remember sitting in class one day and my coach coming and pulling me out of class and saying we were going to play our rivals that week. And these are the people right across the river that we didn't care if we won any other games, but we had to beat this team. And so everybody's hyped up and nervous. And he said, hey, you're going to play running back this week. And I thought, wow. Goodness gracious. So really, I turned into kind of the kid that I knew all the plays, so I could really kind of jump from both sides of the ball. And so I kind of played that multi-purpose role, which, again, as I look back, I was a little bit bitter at the time. But reality was the team needed me in different places. And that's really what life is all about. It's being able to change and move where they need you and participate in a team atmosphere. And so ultimately, we made the playoffs and outperformed what anybody thought we would do. And I remember a parent coming up to me afterwards that had a big impact on me that said, you know, he just mentioned to me that he thought, you know, my contribution to the team was one of the most important of all season. And we had some really, really good athletes that obviously shined. But I think the fact that they could stick me in any role and I did my job was something the team needed. So on one side,
well,
you know,
that played out a little bit later, as we talked about in your bio. It sounds like you did pretty much every job at Gulf Winds as well. So
that's right.
We'll get to that in a minute. What about entrepreneurial things? Were you involved in any, you know, money making schemes or extra pocket money, or did sports pretty much take up most of your time after school?
Yeah, no, most of my time was spent in sports. And obviously, I did the normal things that kids did back then, which was mow the yard and do the things around the house. My dad was very much a perfectionist in a lot of ways. So I used to joke that I kind of had the dad that if you mowed the yard and you missed a spot, he would catch it. And so,
I had one of those dads too.
so I got really good at mowing and edging and, you know, of course, today you talk about mowing the yard and and washing cars and that kind of stuff. And kids think about driving to a car wash or hiring somebody to do it. So things have changed for sure.
Yeah, they certainly have. What were some of the jobs that you did in high school? Anything outside the home that kept you busy or during college?
Yeah, I had a lot of different jobs through my teenage years, which honestly I look back on as something that was very beneficial for me. One of my very first jobs that I had was I went to work for a paint and body shop that was just right down the street. They were moving. It was summertime. And so they basically hired myself and a friend to do the moving. And so we had a lot of crazy stories about moving just different car parts and things out of a field and from one location to another. And I learned a lot from the owner of that shop, who frankly was paint and body shops are a little bit different. I learned probably more than I needed to know outside of just work. But he was very creative in a lot of ways. And I remember one summer, that hot summer, we were digging a ditch, and that was my friend and I's job because they had a drainage problem. So he's like, sent his two high school kids out there to dig the ditch. And man, we were sweating and working all day trying to dig that ditch. And he drove up and he drove this huge, old, beautiful, bright canary yellow Bronco. And it had been all redone. It had like 38-inch tires on it, which is a big deal. And of course, as a kid, you know, we just wanted to drive it. So he said, "Hey, what are y'all doing out here?" And so we said, "Well, we're sweating and we're digging this ditch." And he said, "Man, I got a great idea." And so he jumps in that Bronco. He says, "Get out of the way." And he puts one tire off in the ditch and he starts to power brake, and he literally digs the ditch as he's power braking. So what, you know, that was a great lesson though, in a crazy way. Like, yes, this guy's very creative and he finds different ways to do things. And so that was one job. And I also busted tables at a Italian restaurant that was in Houston. So that was a great job, as you learn how to serve others.
Service industry. Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely. And absolutely. So that was something that I look back on with good memories. And over college, I worked at a place called Lufkin Industries in a foundry for a little while. Mm-hmm. And they actually would take those forklift counterweights out of the hot mold. And they had a whole group of people that would actually bust that stuff off of them until they were clean enough to be painted.
Oh, wow.
And so definitely had some jobs that were
very diverse,
labor intensive. Did work in the warehouse, which frankly something that I never dreamed I would do later on in life. Obviously that we have a big warehouse now, but I worked as a laborer in a warehouse one summer as well and learned a lot there. And made some great relationships and have some great faith stories that have come through that as well.
Well, I know that from your story when we met back in May that Dad started Gulf Winds. Is that right? Was that his business after he left the shipping industry?
That's correct. He was laid off in his early 50s with a big merger, and Gulf Winds was birthed through his 401k money, which...
Right. I remember the story. Yeah. And so did you do some work for him? Was that during your college years? It must have been, right? Because I think you went right into Gulf Winds after you graduated.
Yeah, well, we were starting literally right as I graduated.
You were. Okay, got it. So it was even before that. So it was outside. So was it a foregone conclusion that you'd go to college? Did Mom and Dad go as well?
Yeah, it was a foregone conclusion. My mom had gone to nursing school. I think my dad was the first, might have been the first college student on his side of the family, but he was in Vietnam as well. And ultimately, I always assumed that I would go to school. I never even thought I would go somewhere else.
Austin State, was that your first choice and where you wanted to go straight away? Or what made you kind of pick to go there and study marketing?
You know, honestly, I didn't know what I wanted to do. At the time, you know, I had a long-term girlfriend, and it was a place where, frankly, we went, and I had other friends going there, a lot of folks from my high school that decided to go there. And so I'd like to say that I had a big plan and that God was going to work that out, but reality was I was kind of just a 17-year-old, graduated at 17, just trying to figure out what, you know, what God wanted from me, and didn't even know that he would introduce himself to me a few years later.
Right. So you came to the Lord while you're in college. Is that correct? Or was that after graduating?
Well, I prayed to receive Christ as a senior in high school. That was after my grandfather had told me I needed Christ. But really, I didn't surround myself. I really had no Christian models around me that gave me the discipleship that I really needed. That's not an excuse, just a reality. I didn't really have folks that were, even those that were claiming Christ, really weren't living a life that now I would say is directed by Him. So went off to school, joined a Sigma Chi fraternity a couple years in, and so kind of just did the normal college thing. But in hindsight, I can see where God put people in my path that sort of guided me a little bit. I had a workout partner in college that had been in the Marines, and he'd been saved through a near-death experience that he had after he got back. And he would pray before we worked out. And I just remember a couple of things. Number one was, you know, he worked out really hard, and he was just a great partner during that time to work out with. But more importantly, he took time to pray and talk to me. And I wasn't even really that spiritually inclined at the time. But I just remember that kept me out of a lot of late nights, because he always wanted to work out at like 4:30 in the morning.
Oh, my gosh. Wow.
So it did create a level of discipline in me. Which was great. And when he graduated, he had actually started a little training routine where he trained a couple of one of the business owners in town that was in. So he basically transferred that responsibility to me whenever he left. So that gave me a little bit of way to do something that I enjoyed, but also help people.
Yeah, awesome. And then graduated, first job out of college, as we mentioned earlier, was with Gulfwind. So mom and dad got that started. Did they have any employees beyond you when you joined at that time?
No, they opened in April. We had one customer, one location. Wow. And I graduated that summer, so went to work late that summer. And, you know, we were still a very small company at the time.
Yeah.
My dad, actually, there were a couple of other people that were involved. One gentleman that I had worked for in the summer, who was our general manager of warehouse operations. And then my dad's partner, who he gifted 50% of the company to with no financial investment, which that played out later, who was really the guy that was doing some of the operational stuff inside as it related to trucking and warehousing. My dad was really kind of the face, more of the sales end of the business.
Business development. So do you get into leadership positions pretty early on as you did your rotation from forklift operator to inventory control and the other types of things that you did in those early days?
Well, in a small business, you have to do a little bit of everything.
That's right.
So for me, it was, like I said, working for me wasn't a hard thing, as far as I just felt like this is something we're investing in for the long haul. And I remember sweeping, you know, we had a 75,000 square foot warehouse that we were leasing right out of the gates. And, you know, we had to sprinkle the floor and with floor sweeps and actually hand sweep it. And just some crazy things early on. We had to keep it really clean because we were storing green coffee. So we were food grade. I remember our general manager of warehouse operations would put me on a man lift, and he would lift me up, and my job was basically clean the cobwebs out of the rafters, because if you get spiders, they can take your permit and then you're out of luck. So, but he made it so fun. You know, it was so hot and tiresome, but he'd call it surfing the web before that was a reality.
I love it. I love it. What were some of the earliest lessons that you learned from mentors like that in the organization?
I think just have fun, work hard, and enjoy what you're doing. And that's something for me, like I said, that I never really disliked work, so to speak. So for me, it was about, you know, everyone has to work. So why not have fun while you're doing it? And you can surround yourself with some people that do that. And certainly Bruce taught me that early on, that you can be digging a ditch, unloading a 100-degree container of coffee with 130-pound sacks. And as long as you're
cobwebs.
Yeah, laughing. And if you can laugh in the process, it's amazing what that does to your mentality and your ability to keep going. And I always look to the sort of the future, if you will, that, hey, we're building something here, and didn't know that, have any idea how, where it would be today, but certainly every little step was important along the way, from customer service to safety and dispatch and all the little things that went into it. It was kind of again, one day, hey, wear your jeans today, and the next day maybe make a sales call. So you have to do a little bit of everything in a small business.
Do you remember the first time you started managing people, Todd?
looking back, fairly early on, I started being involved with some of the hiring. And so it was, once you start hiring people, then you're kind of responsible for them. So,
that's right. Yeah.
So yeah, that was that, and probably on the customer service side is where I started to have a little more influence, if you will. Part of that was we were, you know, starting with some new technology and different things. And not that I was by any means a technology expert, but you have to remember at that time, email was just coming out and right. The internet was getting big. So it was all new. And I had just come out of school. So I was probably the closest in age to at least mm-hmm. being a little more comfortable with that.
Right.
And so I kind of got thrown into the role kind of by default of the guy that was going to be the computer guy in the company. And so that was probably the that customer service side is probably where I initially first saw leadership opportunities. And then on the sales side, obviously producing sales and then helping others to do the same.
Right. Right. Well, the company went through a pretty major transition early on, as I recall from your story. Tell us a little bit about that when your dad began to have some health problems.
Well, that was really, I wouldn't say it was early on. It was a little bit later. But we went probably 15 years with,
15
you know,
years. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, about 15 years into the business. And really, it was more than just the health issue that had come up at the time. The bigger deal was the partner that my dad had gifted the stock to had basically decided that he wanted to move on. And he didn't come out and say that. And so it was difficult because, you know, he wanted to value the company. And so we went into this with the idea that we're just going to see what the company's worth. And ultimately that led to just a lot of stress and challenge because with a 50-50 partnership, you're really at a crossroads. And
he wanted to be bought out, basically.
Ultimately, that's what it came down to, but that wasn't put forward that way in the beginning.
Interesting.
And so it led to some heartache on both sides and some very stressful times for sure. And my dad in the process was diagnosed with leukemia.
Wow.
And so obviously all of that coming together at the same time put a lot of pressure on me because I'm the only child thinking, man, you know, I've been president in training at this time and I've got a mom and dad who are, you know, very committed to the organization and I need to take care of them being the only child and what's that going to look like? And at the same time, my faith walk, you know, had really taken off over the last several years. And so my real love and passion, obviously, was the gospel and seeing a lot of.
What was kind of the moment when that took place? You know, you mentioned that it had gone on for some time before you encountered these problems. What was kind of the event where you kind of really began your faith walk?
Well, I was invited by one of the guys I played football with in high school to a men's Bible study. And for the first time in my life, I started reading the Bible for myself and realized, wow, God can actually speak through this word to me personally. And I'd be at church and the pastor would be talking about the same thing I was studying. You know how the Holy Spirit starts to work on a person and really speak to their heart. And so I was convicted that I'd never really stood for Christ. I knew I'd kind of mouthed a prayer, but ultimately I was not standing for Christ. And I was newly married a couple of years in and thinking, man, this marriage thing's harder than I thought too. And, you know, right. So ultimately, a pastor was preaching a message called God's going to give you opportunity and you have to seize the moment. And I remember never forget just looking at her, feeling a deep conviction over, just the fact that I need to stand for Christ and I haven't done that publicly and I need to be baptized. And so I literally stood up out of my pew that day and walked forward. And from that moment on, literally, I was baptized. I shared my testimony publicly, just about God's work in my life. And it was in Humble, Texas, at a Baptist church there. And a lot of the people in the audience had known the Todd before and they saw the Todd after. And it was highly transformational for me and for those around me. So from that point on, literally, I was kind of shot out of a cannon and started sharing my faith.
How long did it take you to invite the Holy Spirit into Gulf Winds from that point on?
Not long at all. I was so convicted that other people needed to know Christ and just the joy and the peace that he had brought to me personally. And so I literally started sharing, I would say, right out of the gates. And that started with just small conversations with people at the office that I knew. And amazingly, people started saying yes. And that shocked me because I was by no means a Bible scholar. In fact, I didn't know the least thing.
You're a new Christian. Yeah.
I was a brand new Christian. But God fixed that as well. He, a guy at church actually asked me to help co-teach with him.
Wow.
And I thought, man, I can't do this. I don't know that. I mean, I wasn't in Sunday school, you know,
right,
I'm just in, but out of my mouth and my spirit, you know, my mouth was saying, or my spirit was saying no, but my mouth said yes.
Mm.
And so God really grew me up in a hurry, and I would be literally be up till 1 or 2 a.m. studying. I'd have to read the book the night before. You know, I was really putting in the hours preparing for the lessons that I did teach every other week. And
awesome.
What was awesome is it grew me up faster than most, and my passion began to grow even more. So God has a way of catching you up and giving the years back that the locust ate, right?
All right, there you go. So fast forward to this transitional period, both with the partner and with Dad's health, you know, how was Christ involved in that effort? How did you kind of invite God in to help you through what was probably a very stressful time?
Well, I had joined C12 by that time, which was, I think I joined C12 in 2012. And obviously...
And for those that are listening that don't know C12, C12's a group, a peer advisory group of CEOs, business owners, and folks that have a commitment to Christ. And gosh, we're about 2,600 members worldwide now, I think, with a couple of 100 or 150 different groups. It's a fantastic organization. And how many years have you been involved now, Todd, with C12?
Since 2012.
2012. Okay, cool. Join the organization.
Yeah, so that it came around really at a great time because that was about the time, and that was God's doing as well. That was about the time that I needed someone to talk to. You know, I had my dad on one side that I was trying to figure out, you know, what we were going to do there. My dad, by this point, had come to the Lord. He had been saved and baptized at 58. So that was one of my greatest joys to see that. So he was on board with me. And the partner was kind of going a different direction. And so it was really pretty clear the divide. It was either going to be, we're going to continue the company and the mission that we have. And by this point, you know, we were giving to ministries and we'd been taking people on mission trips. And so I was all in. And then all of a sudden, there's this huge wrench that's thrown into the equation. And I'm thinking, I can't believe this is happening because God is doing so much.
And
so I was highly convicted that no, God wouldn't build this thing to this point for me to turn around and just take a buyout. And so, but that was easier being said than done because obviously when you're 50-50 partnership, there's a lot of challenges. So I confided a lot in my C12 chair and we began to pray and they prayed, had a lot of people praying fervently that knew where I was and what I was dealing with. And so I prayed through it and I remember a lot of late nights and sleepless nights. And I remember God giving me a passage of scripture and basically that brought real clarity to the reality that there's no way we could sell this business and that I really needed to separate from this partner. And so ultimately, I began to pray that God would provide a way because with a partnership like that, it's nearly impossible. And so for me at the time, you know, I just began to pray, Lord, there's nothing I can ultimately do to stop this. You're going to have to do it. And so we prayed fervently for a good period of time. Meanwhile, Dad was, you know, going through his issues with health. And so one day I was the kind of the front man for all the private equity guys that came in. And so I took them on the tours and showed them all of what we were doing. And we got a huge offer for the business. And I thought, man, it's just, you know, what do I do? I'm at a crossroads. And on one side, if I'm honest, you know, there was a big part of me that said, gosh, do I just take the money and take care of mom and dad and just get away from this whole situation?
Right.
But my spirit just would not allow that. And ultimately, the partner showed up in my office one morning. We hadn't even really been speaking. And he said, I don't think we should do it.
Wow.
And we were 30 days from close.
Oh my gosh.
As it turns out.
You were selling the whole thing. The company was literally moving to private equity.
Well, we would have still been involved, but
minor,
yes, it was a big
ownership.
Deal. That's right.
Yeah.
We would have given up majority ownership. And so just God answered the prayer, and that gave me a boldness that really I needed to say, okay, for me and my dad, okay, we're not heading that direction. Now the gate's been closed, so we can now move forward full steam with what we want to do. And but that also meant what we didn't realize was that's going to mean we have to figure out a buyout path for the partner.
Yeah,
because we tried it for a little while, but ultimately we knew it wasn't going to work. And so
and you're eventually able to get that in agreement with him.
That's correct.
Cool. Great story. Tell me a little bit about how your leadership style has evolved over time. You've been with the company now, we won't say how many years, but I know it's got to be 20 plus. Yeah. When did you take over the presidency? What was that, when dad officially passed? And or had you were you doing the day-to-day while he was still ill?
Yeah, I took over as president in 2012.
Okay. And about the same time you joined C12.
Yeah, around that same time. So again, it was perfect timing, just putting people around me that could, you know, speak good counsel into my life, godly counsel, just help me in that area. So, that was when I took over. And, you know, really, we have a great young team that had been really operating at a high level for some time. And so in some ways, I had already been doing a lot of it anyway. My dad had kind of already stepped out. He was traveling more with my mom, and you know, they were getting older and wanting to kind of get back some of those years.
Enjoy their lives. Yeah.
And even the partner, he was out quite a bit. You know, he was playing golf a couple times a week, so he just wanted to touch base enough to know where the business was and that finances and things were right. But we had already, in a lot of ways, been running the business, so to speak, and in particular, driving sales for some time. So I think, you know, from that perspective, for me, honestly, the bigger part was just, you know, actually officially getting the title from my father and figuring out, you know, I knew kind of where we wanted to go. It's funny, as we were moving recently from one office to another, I found an old email that I had sent to my dad and his partner back in 2007. So this is 5 years before I took over as president.
Wow.
And I've got it hanging in my office because there's seven things here that I talked about that I wanted to see. And it's what's awesome is that most of it has come to fruition. And so it's neat to see how God kind of puts a vision in your heart, and in time, he sees that through when you're faithful, obviously. But it doesn't mean it's not without a lot of pain and suffering along the
and
way.
And a lot of hard work, right?
Right. That's right.
You know, family-owned businesses, you know, company cultures are extremely important. Tell us a little bit about, you know, kind of what's unusual or unique about, you know, the Gulf Winds culture and, you know, what people talk about with regards to the wow of working there.
Well, I think the first thing that people think about when they think about Gulf Winds is probably the mission. You know, our mission is to glorify God by providing world-class logistics services through continual investment in our people, our clients, our community, and the world we live in. And so I think if you ask our customers and other people, I think we provide excellent service across the board. We're very committed to that. But at the same time, we're really known for being different in the sense that we really do stand on a firm foundation of faith in our business. And so we do a lot of work in the community, volunteer work. We give 10% of our profits to nonprofits. We've planted about 200 churches and hope centers in around 27 countries. So there's a long list of things that we do that are probably a little bit unusual for most in corporate America. And so for me, that's my greatest joy, though, is, you know, we have a benevolence fund for our employees that, you know, that we do anonymously. We have a weekly Bible study. All this has obviously been built over time.
Right.
I always tell people that, you know, it doesn't happen overnight, but you can do something. And we take our people on mission trips, and we've seen some life change and people get saved on those trips. We have marketplace chaplains that come in. We implemented Right Now Media this past year. And so we try and love people well. And but really, I want to do two things, right? We have to have an excellent business, and that gives you a wonderful platform. But I want to be bold for Christ, and that's what God's called me to do and allowed me that opportunity.
Amen. How many employees today?
We've got about 170 employees. Yeah. We have 450 owner operators or truck drivers that we operate between Houston, Dallas, Mobile, Memphis.
They're independents, right?
And New Orleans. They're independent, but they work exclusively for Gulfwinds. Yeah. And we probably have another 70 that work in Houston that are also contract labor.
Right, right. Fantastic. What do you look for when you're making bets on the people you invest in to come work for you?
Well, I think obviously they have to have skills to do the job, but mm-hmm. but the bigger picture for me personally has always been character. Looking for people that I believe can support the mission. And in fact I got a phone call today I was really excited about. I was talking with the lady that does a lot of our design work. Right. And she'd been working with some of our upper level managers across the company, and she made this comment to me. She said, "Todd, one of the things that I'm hearing internally that you'll be encouraged with is that what we're seeing now in our hiring process is that people are coming to us when they ask the question about our mission. They're coming to us because of our mission. They've already done the research. They know what the company's about, and they want to work here because of the faith-based culture." So that for me is huge. Has not always been that way. We don't I don't want to paint a picture that we have, you know, this company of just all Christians. That's not the case. We definitely have those that are not believers. But when you love people well, you treat them well, and you give them opportunity, it's kind of hard not to like that. And so
that's right. It becomes very attractive, doesn't it?
It does. Yeah, and so I've got some people here that obviously just love the way that we treat people. And I think that, you know, obviously that's what being a follower of Christ is all about, is loving people as Christ did. And that involves sacrifice and a lot of other things. But I think people appreciate just the basics, right? Just treating you with respect and trying to do the right thing.
You talked about character, and you know, that's such a hard thing to get at in an interview, right? So how do you kind of get to that? You know, if you had just a few minutes with someone, let's say it's not a direct report, but you know, maybe one of your direct reports says, "Hey, you know, I'm really excited about this guy, but I'm not sure. Would you spend 5 minutes with him?" And you know, if you kind of dug into the character issues, what kind of questions would you ask? How would you kind of get at that that evaluation of character that you mentioned earlier?
You know, I think I'd love to take credit for this, but I'm going to give credit to somebody else, because I asked a recruiter the same question one time and I stole his question. But basically what I ask is, you know, tell me your life story. And as people are talking, generally, we all have a story. And I think so much of our who we are as a person today comes from how we were brought up. Did we have a mother and father that were present? Did both parents work? Did I have a support structure in that? Were they abusive? Were they not? It's amazing what people will tell you if you just ask them about themselves. And I think as you hear their story, you have an opportunity to make that call. And I think the big thing we look for is humility. And that's a big one for us, because, you know, if you're prideful, that leads to foolish decisions and foolish actions a lot of times. And, you know, it's hard, because in an interview, on one side, you're trying to impress.
Right.
But the reality is you want to do that in a manner that's humble. And so, you know, looking for, are they giving other people in their lives credit for things? Are they saying the right things? Are they involved in a church? Do they, or if they're not a believer, do they have a passion that they follow? Do they love animals?
Full of integrity.
Are they committed to whatever that might be in their particular sphere?
Great stuff. Well, Todd, you've been very generous with your time, and we're just about out of it, but we do have one last question we always ask the CEOs in our podcast, and that's, you know, kind of what career and life advice would you give to someone that's listening that maybe has their eyes on the corner office, or maybe is going to take over a family business, or, you know, is kind of struggling between what do I do, you know, when I get out of college? What are your words of wisdom for someone looking forward?
Well, I just think be prepared to work really hard. Don't allow challenges to set you back or get you off track of whatever that vision might be. And I think any great accomplishment always involves sacrifice of some sort. And so be willing to sacrifice for those around you. I think anytime we do that as leaders, it just makes people want to follow. And if you're everyone thinks that the person in the corner office is the one that kind of gets all the perks. But the reality is, really, you're the first one to sacrifice if something goes wrong. And so, you know, companies are built on sacrifice. I look back and I think about getting out of college. I made $250 a week. that was my paycheck. And so yeah. I have it hanging on my wall in here. And my father didn't take a paycheck for a couple years. I remember my mother in tears, you know, working as a nurse, trying to provide for us. And it was a faith journey for us.
Yeah.
And things don't always work out like you anticipate, you know. So enjoy every day. You know, my dad, I miss him, you know, like crazy. And he, you know, he thought he was going to have a lot of years to enjoy, you know, what he worked really hard for. And the reality is God had other plans.
Yeah.
And, you know, we've accepted that. And, you know, it's built my mom's faith and her strength as well. But I just think there's a whole lot involved in people, the people side. If you want to work on one thing to be successful, love people well and work on how to promote those around you. And I think, you know, I read this morning, I was reading the scriptures this morning, and I think I posted something on the fact that the way up is down. Mm. And you just got to be willing to serve people. And I think all my summer jobs and the fact that I worked with a lot of people that didn't have much, I just love talking to the low person on the totem pole, so to speak. And the more you can do that, the higher your organization will go. I really think as you take care of the people at the bottom of the organizational chart, that really dictates how high you can buoy the full organization.
So true. Followers of Jesus, follow Jesus, right? We need to
follow. Yeah. And I would say, you know, even to quote my dad, who came to Christ at 58, he said, "My marriage is better in my 60s, son, than it was in my 30s because of Christ."
Amen.
And Jesus has made all the difference in my life. None of the things that I said in this interview would be done today if we would not be doing the work we're doing in the community. We would not be doing the overseas mission work. All these people that have seen such life change and such marital restoration, none of that would be possible apart from Christ. And so I do believe he is the answer to the world's problems. I've seen so many people just restored, renewed, and again, not without great challenge and struggle. But when you have peace in the struggle, there's just nothing that can replace that. And I've buried employees and friends and family members myself. And I just know that only God can give us what we need at the right times. And that peace only comes through Christ. There's no way around it.
Well said. Todd Stewart, president of Gulf Winds International, thank you so much for sharing your thoughts and your journey into the corner office.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for listening to Into the Corner Office with Brant Hanley. We hope you enjoyed hearing our guest CEO story as much as we did. If you want to hear more CEOs reveal their journey into the corner office, please subscribe via iTunes and tell your friends and colleagues. For more information about Brant, Resource Options International, and the Mighty Middle Market, visit www.goforroi.com. We look forward to having you join us for our next episode.